And now on to our dinosaur of the day, Euoplocephalus, which was a request from Chartley via Patreon and Discord, so thanks. Euoplocephalus was an ankylosaur that lived in the Late Cretaceous in what is now Canada. It was about 18 feet or 5.5 meters long and weighed about 2.5 tons, and it was also about 7.9 feet or 2.4 meters wide. It had a wide body that was flat and a large gut, and it had a wide rib cage. Euoplocephalus was quadrupedal with short, sturdy legs, and it had robust forelimbs that were shorter than the hindlimbs. It probably had a lot of muscles, too. This is based on the fact that it had robust bones. It had a short neck, and its skull was triangular in shape and wider than it is long. It was herbivorous, probably not a picky eater, and it had a drooping snout and a beak to bite off plants. This drooping snout was blunt, wide, and high.
Yeah, you could imagine that it was probably eating stuff off the ground, too, if it had shorter front legs than hind legs, sort of aimed downward.
And in its mouth, it had 19 to 24 teeth in each upper jaw. The lower jaw had 21 teeth, and it could pull its lower jaw backwards. Euoplocephalus' head and body was covered in a bony armor of osteoderms. The neck had these two bone rings called cervical half rings that protected it. Victoria Arbour and others thought that they formed a lower layer, maybe with ossified cartilage. This cervical half ring was several bony plates that were fused together in an arch-shaped block. As I mentioned, Euoplocephalus had bony armor plates with rows of oval scutes. Kenneth Carpenter described the armor in 1982, but it was based on the specimen that's now known as the holotype of Scolosaur, so it's not exactly the same for Euoplocephalus. Victoria Arbour said in 2013 that no Euoplocephalus specimen has in situ osteoderms, so the arrangement of osteoderms is unknown. The armor was made of small scutes, the diameter was less than 5 millimeters, and they may have formed bands if it was the same as Scolosaurus. Euoplocephalus may have had a sacral shield made up of four of these bands, and these bands had horizontal rows of larger, oval, flat scutes. The scutes varied in size on its body. The largest, tallest ones may have been on the shoulder, and it may have had large keeled plates on its upper arms. Old restorations depicted the club with two large spikes. This is based on a restoration of Scolosaurus by Franz Napsche. He based it on a specimen with an incomplete tail. This armor may have helped with protection and thermal regulation. Victoria Arbour and others found an intact Euoplocephalus skull in southern Alberta, and it's at the Royal Tyrrell Museum for study. The armor and the skull had head tiles that fused with skull elements, and the snout looks like a mosaic kind of pattern. Euoplocephalus had two pyramid-shaped squamosal horns that grew from the back of its head, and also had a quadrupedal jugal horn at the lower rear of the skull, and it had bones over the eyes that may have helped to protect them. Euoplocephalus had small eyes, but it had a good sense of smell, though the olfactory part of the brain wasn't that large. It had two external nostrils on each side, and very complex air passages and sinuses. In 2018, Jason Bork and others used CT scanning and computational fluid dynamics to simulate how air moved through the crazy nasal passages of Euoplocephalus and Panoplosaurus, and they found that their noses could warm and cool air that it breathed in, and that helped cool down the brain.
I think we covered that when they discovered that, too.
Yeah, 2018, makes sense. The nasal passages may have moistened the air that it breathes in, and these nasal passages looked kind of like crazy straws. In Euoplocephalus, these nasal passages were almost twice as long as the skull. The team also reconstructed blood vessels based on bony grooves and canals and found a rich blood supply running next to the nasal passage. Porter, who worked on the study, said, quote, "Hot blood from the body core would travel through these blood vessels and transfer their heat to the incoming air. Simultaneously, evaporation of moisture in the long nasal passages cooled the venous blood destined for the brain," end quote. So Euoplocephalus's large size was good for keeping warm, but not good for cooling off. There's a risk of overheating, especially the brain tissue. The nasal passages were looped and complex, possibly also for vocal resonance or to balance heat and water.
Yeah, so the idea is that it would lose less water through breathing by having this sort of mechanism to cool off and warm up air as like a sort of radiator in its head.
Pretty cool.
Ankylosaurs are cool.
Yes, yes. So Euoplocephalus also had a large vascularized chamber at the back of the nasal tract, which may have helped improve its sense of smell. It could probably hear low frequencies. Possibly you could hear the low sounds from the nasal passages. Euoplocephalus had a heavy club-like tail. This tail was like a hammer. It's long. It had a bony club. It probably held the tail just above the ground, and it probably swung the tail low. The base of the tail was flexible, and then the club was rigid. And it may have used this club tail for defense or even for combat between themselves. Euoplocephalus may have been a solitary animal. It may have mated the way cats mate. This is based on Kenneth Carpenter's book in 2000 about dinosaur reproduction. He wrote that a common method, quote, might be for the female to squat on her forelimbs, raising her rear to the air, sort of like a house cat, end quote. There's only one species. It's Euoplocephalus tutus. Lawrence Lamb found the first fossil in August of 1897 in what is now Dinosaur Provincial Park in Alberta, Canada. In 1902, the fossil was named the holotype of Stereocephalus tutus. It had part of the cranium and five scutes that were part of a cervical half ring. The genus name Stereocephalus means solid head, and that refers to its armor.
That's a pretty good name.
Yes, but it turns out that name was already used for the beetle Stereocephalus back in 1884, so the dinosaur was renamed Euoplocephalus in 1910, and that means well-armed head.
The name was too good. It had already been used.
Yeah.
Although not that long. He only missed it by 18 years, it looks like.
It was long enough. Yeah. The species name tutus means safely protected in Latin. In 1915, Edwin Hennig reclassified Euoplocephalus as Paleocincus, but now Paleocincus is considered to be a nomen dubium because it's only based on indeterminate ankylosaur teeth.
Oh, those teeth names. Don't name things based on teeth.
Well, this was a long time ago.
I know.
In 1964, Oscar Kuhn referred Euoplocephalus to Ankylosaurus. A lot of ankylosaur fossils were found in North America in the 1900s that were named new genera. That just goes for a lot of fossils in general found in the early 1900s in North America. But anyway, in 1971, Walter Coombs reclassified many of those as Euoplocephalus, and he synonymized Anodontosaurus, Dioplosaurus, and Scolosaurus with Euoplocephalus, which meant that there were now 40 specimens that were Euoplocephalus, and also meant that Euoplocephalus spanned about 10 million years and was the best known ankylosaurid.
Might be ripe for splitting if it's over 10 million years.
Right. In 1978, Combs also renamed Tarkia as Euoplocephalus giganteus. Coombs and Teresa Marianska said in 1990 that Euoplocephalus has four distinguishing traits. Premaxilla that doesn't have dermal ossifications, slit-like bony nostrils. The beak is at least as wide as the distance between the rear maxillary upper cheek and teeth rows, and there are three toes on each foot. Then in 2009, scientists found Dioplosaurus to be a valid taxon because it had triangular claws. In 2010, Victoria Arbour said that Anodontosaurus was also a valid taxon because it had a different skull and cervical ring ornamentation and had pointed triangular knob osteoderms. Paul Pankowski and William Blow said in 2013 that Scolosaurus was a valid taxon. And also in 2013, another study by Pankowski named and described Ukotokia based on fossils originally thought to be Euoplocephalus. And in 2013, Victoria Arbour said that Scolosaurus cutleri, Anodontosaurus lammi, Dioplosaurus acutosquamens, and Euoplocephalus tutus were all valid, and that Euoplocephalus lasted about 2 million years instead of 10.
Now we're nice and split up.
Yep. Victoria Arbour and Phil Curry found in 2013 that Euoplocephalus does not have round osteoderms at the base of the horn at the back of the head. It has sacral ribs that perpendicularly point outwards, and it has keeled osteoderms with a round or oval base, so things that make it a little different. You can see Euoplocephalus at the Hall of Fossils at the Smithsonian National Museum of Natural History in Washington, D.C.
Nice. We've seen some really great pictures from patrons on our Discord of the new gallery at the Smithsonian. It looks awesome.
Hopefully we can visit soon. Hopefully we can visit soon. For those of you who listen to our Dinosaur of the Day segment and you like it, please consider becoming a patron. We take new Dinosaur of the Day requests from our patrons and offer a bunch of other perks as well. So check out our page at patreon.com/iknowdino or click the link on the left.